डियर चिल्ड्रन, वेलकम बैक टू ऑनलाइन क्लासेस। टुडे इन हिस्ट्री वी आर गोइंग टू सी चैप्टर नंबर 6। द टॉपिक इज इंडियन टेक्सटाइल्स इन यूरोपियन मार्केट। सो आवर इंडियन टेक्सटाइल्स वेर सो मच पॉपुलर ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड। सो बाय द अर्ली 18th सेंचुरी, worried by the popularity of Indian textiles, wool and silk makers in England began protesting against the import of Indian cotton textiles. In 1720, the British government enacted legislation means a group of law banning the use of printed cotton textiles, chintz, in England. Interestingly, this act was known as the Calico Act. So at this time, textile industries had just begun to develop in India, so they were not able to compete with Indian textiles. English producers wanted a secure market within the country by preventing the entry of Indian textiles. So the English producers, they wanted a secure market, so they don't want the entry of Indian textiles into the country. So the first to grow under government protection was the calico printing industry. Indian designs were now imitated and printed in England. Imitated means here copied. So now Indian designs, they copied and printed in England on white muslin or plain unbleached Indian cloth. Competition with Indian textiles also led to a search for technological innovation in England. So in 1764, the spinning jenny was invented by John Key, which increased the productivity of the traditional spindles. This spinning jenny is a machine by which a single worker could operate several spindles onto which thread was spun. When the wheel was turned, all the spindles rotated. Next is the invention of the steam engine. It was by Richard Arkwright in 1786. It revolutionized cotton textile weaving. Cotton cloth could now be woven in immense quantities and cheaply too. So after coming of this spinning jenny and a steam engine, the new technologies, the cloth could be woven in a greater quantities and cheaply also. However, Indian textiles continued to dominate world trade till the end of the 18th century. European trading companies like Dutch, French and the English, they made enormous profits out of this flourishing trade. These companies purchased cotton and silk textile in India by importing silver. But as we know, when the English East India Company gained political power in Bengal, we have studied in the previous chapters about the English East India Company gaining political power in Bengal, it no longer had to import precious metal to buy Indian goods. Instead, they collected revenues from peasants and jamindars in India and used this revenue to buy Indian textiles. Next is, who were the weavers? Weavers often belonged to communities that specialized in weaving. Their skills were passed on from one generation to the next generation. The Tanti weavers of Bengal, the Julahas or Momins weavers of North India, Sail and Kaikolar and Devangs of South India are some of the communities famous for weaving. The first stage of production was spinning. a work done mostly by women. The charkha and the takli were household spinning instruments. So these charkha and takli were the household spinning instruments. The thread was spun on the charkha and rolled on the takli. When the spinning was over, the thread was woven into cloth by the weaver. In most communities, weaving was a task done by men. So weaving was done by men. For colored textiles, the thread was dyed by the dyer, known as rangrez. So the thread was dyed, means colored, by the dyer, who was known as rangrez. For printed cloth, the weavers needed the help of specialist block printers, which is known as chipigars. Handloom weaving and the occupations associated with it provided livelihood for millions of Indians. So this weaving work and this occupation gives provided livelihood for millions of Indians. The decline of Indian textiles. The development of cotton industries in Britain affected textile producer in India in several ways. Firstly, Indian textiles now had to compete with British textiles, which are cheap, very cheap also, in the European and American markets. Secondly, exporting textiles to England also became increasingly difficult, since very high duties were imposed on Indian textiles imported into Britain. At the beginning of the 19th century, English made cotton textiles successfully ousted Indian goods from their traditional markets in Africa, America and Europe. Here ousted means to expel or remove from place or position occupied. Thousands of weavers in India were now thrown out of employment. Bengal weavers were the worst hit. English and European companies stopped buying Indian goods and their agents no longer gave out advances to weavers to secure supplies. Distressed weavers wrote petitions to the government to help them. So you have seen in this paragraph how Bengal weavers were worst hit. They were thrown out of employment. English and European companies also stopped buying Indian goods, and their agents also no longer gave out any advances to weavers to secure the supplies. So they were very much distressed, and they wrote petitions to the government to help them. Petitions means a request made for something desired, especially a respectful or humble request. But worse was still to come. By the 1830s, the British cotton cloth flooded Indian markets. By the 1830s, Indian markets were full of British cotton cloth. In fact, by the 1880s, two-thirds of all the cotton clothes worn by Indians were made of cloth produced in Britain. So this affected not only specialist weavers but also spinners. So due to this, thousands of rural women who had a living by spinning cotton thread were rendered jobless. They became jobless. Handloom weaving did not completely die in India. This was because some types of clothes could not be supplied by machines. How could machines produce saris with intricate borders or clothes with traditional woven patterns? These had a wide demand not only amongst the rich but also amongst the middle classes. Nor did the textile manufacturers in Britain produce the very coarse clothes used by the poor people in India. Handloom weaving did not completely finish in India. because some types of clothes could not be supplied by machines, like saris with intricate borders or clothes with traditional woven patterns, etc. So these had a wide demand not only among the rich people but also among the middle classes also. And nor did the textile manufacturer in Britain, they cannot produce the very coarse clothes which are used by the poor people in India. You must have heard of Solapur in western India and Madura in south India. These towns emerged as important new centers of weaving in the late 19th century. Later, during the national movement, Mahatma Gandhi urged people to boycott imported textiles and use hand-spun and hand-woven clothes. So Gandhiji asked people to boycott imported textiles, that is, not to use the imported textiles, instead of that to use hand-spun and hand-woven cloth. Khadi gradually became a symbol of nationalism. The charkha came to represent India and it was put at the center of the tricolor flag of the Indian National Congress, adopted in 1931. So you all have seen the Indian flag. So there are three colors on the flag. So the charkha came to represent India and it was put at the center of the tricolor flag. What happened to the weavers and spinners who lost their livelihood? Many weavers became agricultural laborers. So those who lost their livelihood by weaving and spinning, these weavers, they became agricultural laborers. Some migrated to cities in search of work, and yet others went out of the country to work in plantations in Africa and South America. So some people became agricultural laborers and some moved to the cities in search of work, and some of them went to plantations in Africa and South America. Some of these handloom weavers also found work in the new cotton mills that were established in Bombay, now it is Mumbai, Ahmedabad, Solapur, Nagpur and Kanpur, because they are more experienced in the weaving work. So children, for today's class, this much only. Tomorrow we are going to see how the cotton mills come up. Thank you very much.